we're on, maybe. I hope. Might not be.
All right, out of game.
Nice, just in time. Okay, and we're live. Perfect.
Wait, are we actually live right now?
Yeah, of course.
Holy shit.
I told you, we need to make sure we get here in time. Mustn't be late for the podcast.
I mean, I'm here, man. I'm not going anywhere. I'm not even going to honor a teammate because I'm already all tabbed out.
Did the screen share work for you?
Yeah, I can see it. Okay. I feel like it didn't work like one time last blip, and I don't know why, but now it's working every time.
Yeah, it was. I think it was while it was new as well. But what's up, Paladin? That's an emote. All right.
Alright, so let me pop out Twitch chat. Alright, Twitch chat, you just got popped the fuck out. Wait, did I miss this meme? Sky Zero isn't so great, are you kidding me? Holy shit, dude. I've never seen that meme before. I feel like I've been missing out.
I feel like I saw it, but...
Oh, I don't know. Maybe I just missed it. I'm just not on top of things.
Yeah, I feel like we're getting the copypasta out of the way immediately here. Thanks, Chris. Yeah. I was going to say, I thought I'd seen it. I hadn't actually read the whole thing, though. That was about double lift, right? Originally?
I don't know if it was. I don't know. I'm just not. I don't keep up to date enough with the copypasta.
Yeah, I thought it was like about it, like. No, there was a different one that was about his bowl cut. Maybe it is about double lift still. I'm not really sure. I don't know about weird flex, but okay, breaking records either.
I mean, they might break some records. You know, like how many. How many different positions has, you know, one person played in during one split? Is that a record that we have?
Still no marbles. Oh, jeez.
Imagine marbles in 2019.
Since Maris took over. So... The entire duration of the podcast has gone downhill. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's unfortunate. Noxus is still haunting Gold Capped. I'm not sure it ever left. You can take the Noxus out of Bilgewater, but it's still there.
Wait, why did we decide Bilgewater's Noxus?
It's got way more Noxus people.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I'll see if we can get some marbles next week. I'll have to see what the time looks like, but maybe we could do it. I think I said that last week, though, and then I never opened it.
So, do you see, like, the at GetRec TV? Does that at you?
No. I'm not logged into that account. I'm Meristematic.
Gotcha. You're this still just... Gotcha, gotcha.
But I'm on the GetRec dashboard. I don't know if that makes a difference. But yeah, I think the only person logged into GetRec TV is Jack. And I don't know that he's even logged in there all the time, because I think he's got like Jack Loves Lamp as well.
For sure, for sure. It'd be kind of cool if you could do like at broadcaster for like when people are broadcasting to.
It has no way to know that I'm broadcasting right now, is the other thing.
Wouldn't it? Like, like, just one key that everybody uses then?
So, I think in this case, yeah, there's one key that everyone's using. In other cases, you can send stream keys to certain people based on their email address, and it would kind of tie to them. But you don't, like, actually put in who is actually streaming. It's all just on that channel.
Does Twitch track who uses the stream keys, I wonder? Like, would Jack be able to see, like, oh, which stream key used this when and what they use it for?
Not in this case, because I'm pretty sure we're all using the same stream key.
If there were different ones, I just wonder if Twitch is set up that you can differentiate between them.
I don't know. I'm pretty sure they think that you're going to take care of your own account security in that case.
For sure. I mean, giving out your stream keys...
It's a no-no, and it tells you it's a no-no. Anyway, here's the intro video. Sorry, we can't talk over the timer. The timer is obviously God. It's just going to cut off our speech, you know, right in the middle. Anyway, welcome to the GetRECalled podcast. It's week number two. If you haven't caught on by now, I'm Meristematic. With me is my guest, Aikado.
Hi, I'm Aikado. This is Meristematic with me.
We're flipping the intro.
I wanted to feel like I was contributing.
That's fair. This week, gonna be a little bit of a different week. I apologize. I got kind of crunched on time due to work and a couple of other things. So we don't have any interviews this week. It's just gonna be Aikado and I talking to each other. But first, you get to hear from me a little bit about some things that are grinding my gears specifically. Then we're gonna review week one, go over how we did on our predictions. And then we'll let Aikado talk for a little while about what's grinding his gears this week, and then we'll preview week two. So I guess I will start things off. The first thing I wanted to talk about is personal branding. Now, there are a couple of... I've had this discussion on the podcast before. Your personal brand, coming back to what name you use, how you choose to interact with chat, how you choose to interact with people in general, it all comes back to reflect on yourself. So, you should be proud of your personal brand. It's something that you want to build, something that you want to grow, something you want to be proud of, because it helps reflect your growth as a person, and it helps reflect upon you. If you hear somebody talk about Meristematic, you probably get a very specific idea or feeling about that and that brand. Now, if you change your summoner name every week, for instance, maybe even change it to specifically reflect somebody on the enemy team, that's really not being proud of your personal brand. It's also kind of bullying, which I don't specifically condone, but it's not being proud of yourself as a person. Now, if for instance maybe you change your name, summoner name every week to bully somebody on the enemy team, and then also come on the cast and start trying to be a serious caster, I don't think that that reflects particularly well on your personal brand, and I don't necessarily need to listen to what you have to say, and I think it really weakens any arguments or points that you try to make and hinders your future opportunities. The other thing I want to talk about is first a direct apology to Tastes Like Armageddon from last week. I incorrectly said that they're a three plat team. I kind of did more research, more accurate research, I guess I should say. They're a one plat team. They're clearly terrible. But I did want to apologize for calling out people who didn't need to be called out. I also wanted to point out that my definition of a plat player as we're going forward here. We see I support my team here. Thank you. Great guy. He is a plat player. He's in platinum right now, was platinum last season. Very clear. Someone else who I've also called a plat player in the past would be like my own teammate Hulk, who's been, sandbagging on me this whole time. He finished plat in season 5 and season 6, therefore could refer to him as a plat player in Gold League. Not very happy with Hulk right now. We might have to discuss this internally just a little bit more. But, yeah. Anyway, let's talk about diamond results for week number one, shall we?
Yeah, shall we?
Landsnek beat Team Fish Taco 2-1. Return of the Middle Sticks beat Graceland 2-0. Unlucky Retribution with a 2-0 over those thumb guys from Spy Kids. Iron 5 with a 2-0 over the Broncos. And 2-0 for Good Game Losers over Sky Zero. Anything really standing out to you that you want to talk about?
So first thing is the Landsnek versus Team Fish Taco. I predicted Team Fish Taco to come out on top. I would like to point out that Landsnek didn't have their listed starting roster. As far as I know, Landsnek has like three different subs. So going forward, I think depending on the subs that they use, they could go anywhere from a team that could contend for, third or fourth place to a team that cannot. And this time around, they ended up bringing in Himana on support, who's probably one of the better supports in the league, combined with Rito Torchic in the bot lane, and they came in with a really strong bot lane and played around it, and more power to them coming out on top there.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting the different looks that Landsnek and maybe some other teams can have when bringing in substitute players. If you bring in a player that's a little bit better than your starting roster, it can help really inflate or deflate expectations. It's kind of a weird situation that you wind up in as a result of this league.
For sure, it's definitely interesting. From here on out, looking at Snek and trying to determine their actual how well they'll end up doing. It'll definitely be interesting because I feel like personally, it's very much based on who they actually end up playing with.
So to recap our game of the oh, I had a slide built for this. Cool.
Oh
I
shit, my
didn't
bad.
remember. I did this earlier this week. Okay.
So yeah, Team Fish Taco and Snek. Snek was smurfing when they signed up and brought in the ringer this time.
Yeah, and it becomes difficult to evaluate them, like you mentioned, because we have the starting roster listed. You have that listed on the website. It's the one that they're required to provide if you're asking for the roster. Makes it really difficult. Yeah.
Yeah,
Anyway,
I know they
our
drop gold players and pick up like a D2 player. It's like, anyway.
Our game of the week was Unlucky Retribution versus those thumb guys from Spy Kids. It was game number. I don't know. They both played out the same way. It was game number two that was on stream with the Ziggs. But yeah, you can see Unlucky Retribution really go into the well twice. They went to the Caitlyn for give me the name, Tiensama, and then played around him. Had 20 kills in both games. They really played around that AD carry spot, and it's like you mentioned during your corner last week, the AD carry changes kind of really benefiting teams like Unlucky Retribution that like to play around their AD carry.
Agreed, and I think for Unlucky Retribution going forward, there were kind of questions because they did move their support into the jungle and get a new support. So it's like, okay, will their bot lane be as good? Will it be better? How will it turn out? And just based off of these games, we're watching them win 2v2 and get huge leads by just winning 2v2, not even jungle ganks. So I feel like Tien-sama, and I'm blanking on the support. Sorry, give me just a second.
I have it up. I've got you. It's
Tien-sama and
curb
Curb
stomp.
Stomp,
Yeah.
Kirby. I feel like those two are going to be an extremely strong bottom lane. I think last split, Tien-sama and Gavi kind of had some weaker laning phases, and sometimes straight up lost lane. But just based off of these two games, if you want to make the hot take, it looks like they're extremely strong lane. So UR is probably a bit stronger than I thought they'd be.
Yeah, I think more importantly, they really know where their bread is buttered, right? You
For
have
sure.
that strong bottom lane. You can play around bottom lane then. You can draft things like the Karthus that, hey, I can assist bottom lane by pressing R. I can play Ziggs. I can assist bottom lane by pressing R. I'm Shen. I can assist bottom lane by pressing R. And wow, we have a team comp, right?
Exactly. And even Ziggs can walk halfway down river and press R on bottom lane. You can definitely see where they draft around and how they play. So it'll be interesting further down to see if they're able to, show different looks for this team, kind of like how they had promised in their interview last week. But as far as this is concerned, I mean, we knew that they could carry through Tien-sama, and while it's kind of surprising that it was this far of a blowout, good for them.
Yeah, game two, the one on stream, was much closer. Thumb Guys had a pretty good early game, and even the Xin Zhao got pretty ahead, but just not quite that late game carrying potential. And some, I don't want to say interesting picks, but like the Nico and the Darius are kind of more fringe picks, I guess.
For sure, for sure.
But yeah, and that would have been hard knowing now that it's game two after getting blown out in game one. You can see some of their hesitancy when they were climbing back into the game.
Yeah, no, definitely. But either way, it was a good series.
Yeah, so just take a quick look at the diamond standings after week one. Of course, not much separation between any of the teams, but the kind of expected names up at the top there: GGL, Return of the Middle Sticks, Iron Five, Unlucky Retribution, all at 1-0. Landsnek at also at 1-0, but dropped the single game to Fish Taco. Therefore, Fish Taco takes sixth, and then the other four teams kind of bringing up the rear right now.
Yeah, probably a couple of surprises, but ultimately it's pretty close together, and we'll see in the next few weeks some more separation here.
So we'll shift gears into Platinum for week number one. Sensei Squad with the 2-1 over Oklahoma Gold Rush. Shmeh with the 2-0 over Kings of Baron. Meat Beats with the 2-1 over Gecko Slammer Armageddon. And Team Name Here with the 2-1 over iTown. And I just wanted to touch on, I think it's kind of interesting. We're seeing the kind of, I don't want to say the solo carry teams, but the Meat Beats with Seismic, Team Name Here with Reptar. We're seeing those teams have more success here early in the season than some of the teams we thought might have been a little bit more well-rounded.
Yeah, like the Gecko Slammer Armageddon. I think they were a team that I expected to be a good team, as opposed to, one carry. And maybe it's just they haven't practiced enough, or maybe further into the season they'll build a bit more synergy. But at the moment, they ended up dropping it to Seismic's team.
Yeah, I wanted to talk a little bit about Shmez game versus Kings of Baron before we click into the big ones to recap.
Sure.
Basically, that game was dead even until about 13 minutes, and then Shmez had a one damage composition. They had three supports, a Sivir, and a tank, and they grouped up and just won the game on stream. And that was supposed to be the closer of the two. So it looks like their macro might have caught Kings of Baron by surprise, and they just really weren't able to fight off that big death ball nonsense that moved on at about 17 minutes into the game.
It's a Sivir comp, right? You just group and win.
Something like that. So yeah, the other game to touch on was Sensei Squad taking a 2-1 over OGR. The game on stream, I always hesitate to use the word fiesta, but like the lead changed, I want to say three, four, five times. There were throws at Baron. It was a 48-minute game. It was really fun to watch, but it wasn't the cleanest game that we saw in Plat Capped of the Week. But Sensei Squad able to take it home, and I think that really helps drive just a little bit of separation between these two teams, at least.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, honestly, based off of where we had them ranked, I think both of us had them ranked very close to each other, in our preseason rankings. So seeing it go 2-1, I think is extremely good. It shows that neither of them's really lacking, as well as, 48-minute fiestas can be fiestas, but still, it's a close game. So I don't know. I'd say.
Yeah.
So it was a good series.
Our game of the week recap, we had the Meat Beats able just to sneak past GSM. This was another really closely contested series. GSM actually takes game one. This, I know, gets a little confusing based on the layout. So it's the top is one and two. The bottom one is game three. GSM won game one. Meat Beats won game two and three. It was game three that was on stream. With Seismic on Zillion.
Which I think is interesting. I think coming in, we really expected Seismic to be kind of a one-man carry for this team, as he has been in the past for the Meat Beats. But coming in and putting him on the supportive champion that is Zillion, I think it was good. It really showed that Biscuit Titchbit, their ADC, was able to really carry when he does have that support around him. So I think that's really good for them in the future. You know, they're not just a one-note team. They're not just able to play through Seismic.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting that they lost game one with the Zillion for Seismic. They kind of changed their game plan with a more aggressive draft in game two, and then just went kind of back to the well with that Zillion comp. You had the Nocturne Shen for dive. You had the Zillion to help support that dive as well. And just that strong backline with Jinx and Sona. You have a very clear definition of what their team fight is with that comp.
For sure. And I think a big part of that was actually banning Urgot in Game 2 and Game 3. Because it seems like just based off of Game 1, I watched part of it, and then looking at the scoreboard, it looks like they were able to get a pretty big lead there. Poppy ends up 1-8. And, in the other games, once they get him off of an aggressive champion, put him onto Sion, get that tank v tank top lane, it seems like they were able to slow the game down and play a lot more to their strengths.
And a lot of those players for Meat Beats have played together for a couple of splits now, even. And you can see the synergy that they have built in, especially if you go back and watch that game three. There are some calls where GSM's just a little bit split and the teamfight loses because of that, whereas Meat Beats have that very definite call. Their team comp definitely helps with that. You have Nocturne presses R, Shen presses R on him, and then all of a sudden, you've picked somebody, right?
Yeah, sometimes the simplicity is better, as opposed to I imagine it's difficult to actually orchestrate a team fight around Silas or around a Nico support or even around Zoe. Oftentimes it can be hard to really set up the fights that you want with that champion. Whereas Meat Beats had a very straightforward comp. It's pretty obvious what they were going for, and they executed well.
Yeah, so Platinum standings after week number one. Shmeh is actually going to be alone in first based on game score. And then Team Name Hero, Meat Beats, and Sensei Squad all with 2-1 wins. As a result, the other three teams are there between 5 and 7 at 1 and 2, and Kings of Baron are at the bottom there at 0 and 2.
Yeah, again, not a ton of parity. It's the first week, so.
Yeah, a lot of really close games, and I'm really curious to see how it shapes up. Platinum might be the most exciting of the four divisions, weirdly enough, just in terms of closeness of games.
For sure. It's good seeing the 2-1s as opposed to, in some of the other leagues that seems like it's more one-sided, at least the matchups were this week.
Yeah. Bilgewater for week one, if you want to go over the results for me.
Sure. So Weird Flex But Okay ended up losing 2-0 to Future Star Gamer 5. Hearts.Gold 2-0s UCO Broncos. Maximum Effort 2-0 Ghost. Return of the Middle 6 2-0 AVRM2. And High Octane Gamers 2-1 Sleeper Diamonds. So any of those in particular?
I'm going to cheat and see what I have on the next slide. Okay, this is what I wanted to talk about. I wanted to talk about the game that was on stream between these two teams, the High Octane Gamers and Sleeper Diamonds. And Hog made probably the best macro call of the week in any of the three or four divisions, however you want to think about it. There was a moment. So Sleeper Diamonds already have an Infernal Dragon. And second Infernal Dragon's about to spawn. High Octane Gamers kind of call their bluff. Sleeper Diamonds start kind of setting up for the Infernal Dragon, kind of lazy about it. And High Octane Gamers say, "We're taking Baron." Out of nowhere, like 21, 22 minutes, they go take the Baron. And they catch Sleeper Diamonds just basically sleeping. And are able to take that Baron, rally it into that Infernal Dragon, just kind of push down a bunch of towers, take a huge lead in that game. Up until that moment, it had been even Sleeper Diamond's a little bit ahead. And just with that one decision to just kind of, hey, we're going Baron right now, we're able to completely take over that game.
Yeah, and I believe in that game they had, like, Sivir Cassio, so they do it extremely quickly, and it's definitely good for them going forward to see if they're able to make that call and, you know, stick to it in the moment. Yeah, definitely good for them.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting to see, basically, if other teams in the conference can keep up with those macro chops. If you have to kind of expect that they're willing to freewheel on Baron, you need to make sure that you have vision there and that you're making really clear calls to either stop or to trade objectives for them.
For sure. You can't just, you know, fall asleep on them. Ironic, you know, Sleeper Diamonds.
Yeah. our game of the week was Maximum Effort versus Ghost. And yeah, there's not really a whole lot to say about this series, honestly. It wound up being pretty one-sided, with Revenkryst just taking over the series, 28-4 in the two games on Ahri and Lux. Just a really disgusting performance by him.
For sure. It was something that, you know, coming in, we picked it because these two, based off of our rankings, you know, should be relatively close teams. But I think Maximum Effort kind of said, no, not that close.
Yeah, and again, it was kind of interesting, the kind of solo performance really starring here, maybe over a team that we thought was a little bit more cohesive as a whole. And we'll have to see if that carries forward, if that narrative for Gold and Platinum of having that one star player beats out having more of a, maybe a little bit lower ranked, but a more cohesive team.
Agreed. Are there any, like, so if we've seen it in Gold, we've seen it in Plat, are there any Diamond teams that are, you know, just one-man carries?
I mean, Unlucky Retribution kind of plays that way. I don't think they necessarily have to.
For sure.
But with Tien Sama, I think that's... You could make that argument. Mm-hmm. You could also maybe look at Middle Sticks with Tendies, but...
I feel like Demon Print is pretty effective for them. Maybe Sky Zero with Almighty.
Yeah, I feel like even there you can make an argument for other players. I think that there's not really that solo carry team. Even GGL is really a duo carry, as we've talked about.
No, that's Koala. It's 100%
Koala. It's Koala with Yabian to everyone in a while.
No, 100% Koala.
Anyway, back to Gold. Our Bilgewater standings after 1 week. Kind of the expected results, honestly. My team to watch, I think, right now in Bilgewater is going to be Sleeper Diamonds. I thought that they played really well against High Octane Gamers. It was just that one macro call that decided the series, basically. And taking a game off of Hog, I think, really sets them up nicely for the rest of it. I think that they can compete with the top teams in the division, and it'll be really interesting to watch them as they grow through the split.
Do you think there are any other teams that lost this week that you feel like still have a shot or are still, you know, able to vie for those playoff positions?
I don't know about specifically in Bilgewater. I'm trying to think elsewhere. I think you have the... Because more than half of the division makes playoffs in Diamond, you definitely have an argument for one of the teams that lost last week has to make playoffs, theoretically.
Agreed, yeah.
We're going to get to Shadow Isles in a second. I think that there's two teams there that have a pretty good case as well.
Okay. Sure. So that's fine. We can go ahead.
Shadow Isles results, if you want to go ahead.
Yeah, so that was No Apologies taking the 2-1 over Landsneck. Tastes Like Armageddon taking the 2-0 over SEAL Team 6. Unnecessary Roughness taking the 2-0 over Yellow Jackets. Team RKO taking the 2-1 over Oklahomies. And then Ascended Royalty with the 2-1 over Piltover Pokes.
Yeah, a lot of closer games in this division. I wanted to shout out Team RKO. Unfortunately, they kind of are flying under the radar this week. They're not going to get their own slide here or in the preview, even though I think that they're probably deserving of it. But Sivir Me Timbers able to help carry them over Oklahomies in a pretty close series.
For sure, and it was a close series. I guess I was kind of surprised. You know, I recognized the name Sivir Me Timbers before, but I think that they ended up playing extremely well in that matchup on stream.
Yeah, the first one I wanted to highlight was No Apologies beating Landsneck 2-1. this kind of goes right back to the narrative. No mind and their mid laner. Hold on. Scuffed broadcast. Pwnstar. Basically setting up as a duo carry, even kind of a solo carry with No Mind able to kind of carry them through. And we saw them really struggle against Lanceneck, who, by the way, looked a lot better. They had lead. They had a lead in the game they lost on stream. They obviously had a lead in the game they won. So they definitely had opportunities to win, which is something that we're not necessarily used to seeing from Lanceneck. But No Apologies with No Mind and Pwnstar able to play that two-headed monster, able to take it.
For sure. And, you know, Lanceneck was a team that, you know, based on our predictions, I think we had pretty low in terms of expectations coming into the split. You know, there are memes about them winning, you know, two or three games and that being a successful season for them. So coming out the gate and taking a win off of No Apologies, a team that, you know, we had ranked towards the top, at least. You know, I think that shows really good for Schneck and the rest of their split.
Yeah, and then also wanted to touch on Ascended Royalty. Their dedication paying off as they take the 2-1 over the Piltover Pokes. This was, I think, the most surprising result of Week 1 in any division, at least personally, as I expect OSU to kind of pick up where they left off last season. They finished first in Demacia. They showed really strong team fighting and engagement, and basically their team play was unmatched in Gold Capped. And Ascended Royalty said, nah, take a seat. We're going to run this division this split.
Exactly right. I mean, I had gotten this prediction right, but at the same time, I wasn't, you know, super committed to it. I wasn't like, yes, Ascended Royalty will absolutely win this. And they end up sweeping it out over, you know, Piltover Pokes, who expected to do better.
Yeah, our game of the week unfortunately didn't wind up being a whole much of a game. Unnecessary Roughness just kind of slightly swatted away the Yellow Jackets 2-0. The early aggression from Unnecessary Roughness just wasn't able to be matched, and I don't think Yellow Jackets were expecting basically the toolbox to get thrown at them early on in these games.
Agreed. And for a matchup that was expected to be, you know, two of the top teams within the league, let alone within their division, it wasn't even close. So it'll be interesting going forward to see if the Yellow Jackets are able to come back, or if this means that they're not as strong as we expected them to be.
Yeah, and Unnecessary Roughness running, taking some influence from Jingo Squad last split, running the Lux Morgana bot lane in game number 2, did pick up the Lucian mid just for a little bit of more rounded damage, but shout out to the boys at Jingo Squad for the Lux Morgana.
It's broken, man. You're just perma CC'd. Actually, 0 counterplay.
So Shadow Isle standings after week 1. Right now, TLM and Unnecessary Roughness at the top both finished 2-0 on the week. And then just that whole mess of teams with the 2-1s. But Ascended Royalty, No Apologies, and RKO able to take the wins. And the rest of the teams a little bit to work on, including, I think the big surprises are SEAL Team 6 and Yellow Jackets both being 0-2 sitting there at the bottom.
Agreed. I mean, they didn't even end up pulling out a single win when in a division that, based off the other scores within the league, is extremely close. So that game differential could mean something coming down to the end. So I don't think they want to drop another 0-2
week. Yeah, and especially if you're looking at playoffs, I know it's really early. Like, this is week 2. You have 9 games this season. But at the same time, you're at the quarter pole after this week. If you go 0-2, that's a tough hole to climb out of.
For sure. I mean, admittedly, they did play what we expect to be one of the stronger teams in the league, in the Yellow Jackets, playing against Unnecessary Roughness. But still, if you want to win the thing, those are games you have to beat. You know, you have to be able to beat them eventually. So
yeah, and now it's just that extra pressure. That means you have to beat every team that you're expected to beat. You can't have any slip-ups, or else somebody might be right there just gunning for your spot.
Agreed.
So yeah, our prediction recap basically on the week. Right now, Aikado is the lead dog. He's got 15-4 overall, with a perfect Shadow Isles last week. Our lovely viewers had the perfect diamond capped and went 14-5. I'm unfortunately behind right now. I need to do some catch up work, but I'm only one game back at the viewers at 13-6.
You know, you're just cosplaying Hulk. You're sandbagging, but
But you...
I mean, are we surprised that I came out on top? Come on. I could read these teams like the back of my hand. I got them all on lockdown.
I just hope I don't turn into scrambles from last split and wind up like 10, 15 games behind. Got to keep it close here this week.
At least the viewers will, you know, give me good competition. I'd like to point out, again, the one diamond game I lost was because it was Sneck versus TFT, and Sneck brought in the ringer. They were sandbagging with their roster, and then just came in and won. So I don't know. I feel like there should be an asterisk there.
Yeah, same. All right, now we're going to throw it over to Aikido's corner. Let's hear what's grinding your gears this week.
Gotcha. So not as much grinding my gears, just a couple of things I wanted to talk about was, first off, the narrative of the old guard versus the new guard in Diamond Cap specifically, because I'm more familiar with Diamond Cap. I feel like there's very much a divide currently between teams that were around in the time of the OKLCS and then teams that recently, you know, came to be. So these are teams that just came in like last split to the OKLCS. I know they existed before that, but you know, if I didn't know them, then did they really exist? So that's teams like GGL, who are, you know, coming off of winning last split, ROTM, who had a really strong showing last split. I think that just based off of last split, the competition within this league, at least at the diamond level, has risen immensely. So we have a couple of teams that are coming back after taking a split off. These are people who haven't seen these new teams. And that's those Thumb Guys from Spy Kids led by Chris Can't Miss. And then Sky Zero led by Almighty and Dude Perfect. These are people who have been involved in the OKLCS and had great success in the past. And coming in, I think that they are going to be kind of surprised by how good a lot of the other teams that did play last split have become. And, you know, in my rankings, I had them placed as 5th and 6th, so vying for those, you know, last couple of playoff spots. But it'll definitely be interesting to see if they're able to adapt, because just based off of week one, I'm just not sure if they were prepared for, you know, what these new teams were bringing. And then other than that, there has been, you know, a little bit of ruckus about coaching. Apparently Ascended Royalty, is that right? Who had 8 people in their Discord?
Yeah.
In between games? You know, they're bringing in that staff. They got that coaching squad to help them out. We'll see if it ends up paying out. But I think that the concept of a coach at this level is extremely interesting. I think depending on who you can get, sometimes they can be, you know, great boons for a team and really give them a direction, give them, you know, the tools to improve. But I feel like more often than not, if you have that many voices in a Discord call, you know, 8 people in one call is kind of, I just wonder how productive it's going to be. I think that's something that we should keep an eye on in the future, is teams that actually do have coaches, you know, and analysts or whatever staff they're bringing on, and teams that don't, because at this level, I'm just not sure how much it will help them.
Yeah, and I also think it's interesting, some of the teams, at least in the past, had the same org names, but weren't necessarily receiving that coaching and how it even affected them. Like, you had the GSM Gold team. I don't know that they were even really affiliated with, like, the Platinum and Diamond team at any level when that existed. But
I think that with regards to GSM, I think there was some crossover with Thomas, you know, taking a relatively involved stance with that team. But I don't know. I think that there are a lot of teams with coaches who I'm not sure how much help that they really give. So I don't know. How many teams do we know actually have, coaches? It doesn't seem like there's that many.
Yeah. Just ones listed were like Ascended Royalty, Piltover Pokes. I believe RKO has one as well.
Yeah. I don't know. Anyone who's listening, if you have a coach, DM me and give me their solo queue ranks so I can, you know, just track this and see how much they've helped you guys out.
Yeah, apparently Future Star does. I guess technically our team does as well. All the help that Logan
gives us.
Who's your
coach?
Fourth Shot.
Oh, Fourth Shot. Okay. I mean, sure. That's all I have to say
Yeah,
about
I
that.
think winged encapsulates it best. He does love us, but the coach is more of a quotation marks sort of establishment.
No, he's emotional support. He's the team mom, you know. He's there to help you guys out when you need
Yeah,
it.
younger than all of us, the team mom. He's got that. Anyway, let's jump into week two. We're going to start off with Diamond, of course. Lanceneck taking on Graceland University. Unlucky Retribution versus Team Fish Taco. Return of the Middlesticks versus the Iron Five. Sky Zero versus those thumb guys from Spy Kids. I always try to go too fast on that name and mess it up.
There's a
And
lot of syllables in there.
then Good Game Losers versus the Broncos. Yeah.
So I
Do
don't know
you?
which ones we chose to highlight. I have a couple of them I want to talk about.
I
The
wanted to ask
specifically
you.
RTM and Sky. So
Yeah,
go ahead.
both of those we're highlighting.
Okay,
Spoiler.
awesome.
So, do you think that there's a chance for an upset in any of the other three?
It depends on what you call an upset, right? Like Snek versus Graceland. At this point, I would expect Snek to win that. UR versus Team Fish Taco. I mean, there's a world in which TFT ends up popping off and their mid laner ends up carrying, but against DC Decay and the strong bot lane of UR, I don't see one there. And then if the Bronchos end up taking a game off of GGL, that would be beautiful. Maybe Smite Ignite Rammus isn't the best look for them, but based off of their performance in their games against the Iron Five last week, they can show that they have the potential to get an early lead. So maybe, but I wouldn't expect one, no.
And just to step back a second, Sassiest, I don't think anybody was upset that you had more than one coach. It was just an inconsistency with the express wording of the rules that people wanted to nitpick. And honestly, like Aikado just talked about, I think we're interested to see how much having multiple coaches can influence the way that you play. Anyway, sorry
Yeah,
to
that's all.
interrupt.
No, you're good. You're good.
The first game we wanted to highlight, potential, looking at that last playoff spot, last two playoff spots, but Sky Zero versus those thumb guys from Spy Kids. The divide is pretty close, honestly, with just a little bit in favor of Thumb.
Yeah. So again, based off what I was just talking about, these are two teams who took last split off. They both ended up losing in their games last week. So now they're up against each other. This is the two titans of the old guard coming against each other, and whoever ends up losing, you're looking at a 0-2 coming out of week two, and that's just not good for your playoff prospects. I expect these teams to be really fighting for those last playoff spots, but it'll be interesting to see which one of them ends up coming out on top. I expect it to be a really close game.
Yeah, and there are some roster changes that came through for Thumb Guys. Hallow, moving to the jungle, and then Just Do It as support, and Hestega moving to AD carry, which I think was his original position, if I'm not mistaken.
That sounds right. I'll definitely be interesting. I think that Hallow, no offense to Stega, but Hallow is probably an upgrade in the jungle. But those Thumb guys, Thumb ended up, they previously had what I would consider to be one of the stronger bottom lanes in the league with Saint Elo and Barcone. So we'll see with these roster changes if they're able to, still hold up down there.
Yeah, and Sky Zero, a little bit of a disappointing 0-2 in week number one, against I'm
Did they
down a
play
week.
UR? Who did
Thumbs.
they?
It was UR, yeah.
Yeah.
I think that we expected those games to be a little bit more contested, and it'll be interesting to see if they can bounce back or if they're in their heads just a little bit.
Yeah, Thumbs played UR and then Sky played GGL. So I mean, those are the two Titans of previous playing against, the two strong new teams that they hadn't seen before, and both of them came out, 0-2. So I don't know. It'll definitely be interesting to see how this matchup ends up affecting the playoff runnings down the stretch.
And then our game of the week is going to be your matchup, Return of the Middlesticks versus the Iron Five. I was really surprised at the vote for this. A lot of people in the Middlesticks camp pretty strongly on this one. And I love my Middlesticks boys, but I think that this is going to be a much closer game than 77 to 23%.
Yeah, it just means that there's a lot of people that I get to disappoint. I think that this is a fight for probably as far as rankings go, second place here. So I think this is going to be an extremely close series. ROTM, I think that there were questions coming into the split in my mind about whether FOTC Four Shot would continue to play at a high level when he ends up losing his master tier support, who or Diamond One support. Do you ever hit masters?
He hit it briefly and then fell immediately back out, but yeah.
Yeah, so he had such a strong laner, and they ended up replacing him with another player who was master tier for a month in preseason. So I think that there are questions coming in to see, if they would be able to do as well as they had previously. And based off the games, I wasn't overly impressed. They weren't playing a particularly strong team in Graceland, but there were still points where I saw falters in the bot lane, some 2v2s that weren't very clean. That said, Tendi's played like a monster, and then they ended up pulling out the middle sticks. I don't know. It'll definitely be a close matchup, I think, but I got to go with my boys. I feel like we'll end up eking them out.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting, and I kind of want to spotlight the top lane in this matchup. Liposuction lane has been playing really well recently. I kind of watch his stream every so often, and I'm always really impressed by the level that he's playing at. Maybe his solo queue rank isn't as high, but he does seem a class above the people he's playing with in solo queue, for what that matters. But General Vici had a coming out in the two games. Last week, his Cho'Gath on stream was disgusting, and Cho'Gath himself is a pretty good counter into what Liposuction Lane likes to play. And I think if that matchup goes really well for Vici, Iron 5 is going to be in a really good position. If it doesn't go as well, or if Liposuction Lane can hold himself, I think that the rest of the map feels just a little bit stronger for Middlesticks.
I mean, how can you say that when the Iron Five have, the best jungler in the league?
The jungle's going to
I'm
be a. You got the probably the two best carry junglers in the league, with Tendi's and Aikado, and I guess I'm kind of ignoring Koala. Koala doesn't count, maybe.
I would say with Koala, these are probably the three best junglers in the league.
The level of the junglers is pretty good. We'll say at the top end. We'll just generically run it off. But both junglers like doing a lot of damage, like being involved, and it'll be cool to see the matchup and how the styles play out.
Yeah. I would just like to see, Return of the Middlesticks to also pull out Riven jungle and Fiddlesticks mid against us. I think that they're really strong picks. And I don't know if we have any counters to them. So if you guys want to pick that, it's probably free win. Anyway.
So our predictions, the only difference that we personally have is, of course, the Return of the Middlesticks versus Iron 5 game, which we've discussed a little bit. Everything else, we're going pretty stock standard. We're both taking Thumb Guys over Sky Zero, worth noting.
Yeah, I still expect that to be an extremely close series, but just based off of their performances last week, I feel like we saw a bit more out of Thumb than we did out of Sky.
The chat predictions, you can see that none of them are particularly close. The 98%, the single vote, I believe, it might be two votes for Graceland over Landsknecht. But maybe a little bit hopeful there for them. Good game
Is
losers
there
with the
a way to find
85%.
out?
It's
Can we
40.
find out who put in those votes?
It's not tied to anything. It's pretty
Damn.
anonymous, yeah.
Okay.
And then, yeah, Unlucky Retribution with the 90% over Team Fish Taco. Those are kind of the expected results. We'll have to see if there's any upsets that come on.
Agreed.
Platinum schedule this week. Kings of Baron take on Oklahoma Gold Rush, which officially they're Gold Rush without any other league involved. Just wanted to make that note. Sensei Squad versus Gekko Slayer Armageddon. iTown versus Schmeh. Versus Schmeh. That's hard to. That's like a low-key tongue twister. Anyway, and Team Name Here versus Meat Beats. The game we wanted to one of the games we wanted to highlight was Sensei Squad versus GSM. This, I think, needs to be a bounce-back game for GSM, because 0-2 and Platinum might be a death sentence, right?
Agreed. For a league that's looking to be this close, if you start out 0-2, it is really hard to climb back from that. You know, they only play 7 games. So losing 2 at the start, you have to go on a big run after that.
Granted, I think that they have, in my opinion, the two most difficult teams, with Sensei Squad and Meat Beats in the first 2 weeks. So once they're done with Murderer's Row, maybe they can pick up some wins on the back end. But you have to worry about where your mental's at if you get crushed 2 weeks in a row.
Agreed. And for a team that, you know, had some roster swaps coming in, you know, in just the last couple of weeks, playing together, if you start off, you know, this poorly, I think it's hard to keep a team together and keep a positive mental. Even if weeks down the road, they'll probably have an easier schedule. I think it'll be important for them to show up here and try to get some wins. And if not, then to be, you know, mentally resilient and get the bounce back to try and, you know, pick up the wins down the line.
Yeah. Sensei Squad, for their part, looked pretty good in their win. They had kind of the big Fiesta game on stream from the week, where they had, on the winning team, they had the Ash, who went 0-9, if I'm not mistaken, was boosted Asian. But the rest of the members all looked like they were stepping up and playing really well for them.
For sure. It was a team that I wasn't sure how well they'd perform, but they did perform extremely well last week. An 0-9 Ash, that's every Ash ever, right? She can still press R. Not as effective as she'll ever be. So,
yeah. Our game of the week is going to be Team Name Here versus the Meat Beats. Team Name Here coming off of a good performance where Reptar and Ethereum kind of stepped up pretty big. They swapped around Captain Melonhead and Karasuda in the bot lane during their series, and Karasuda got to play his Kalista in game number 2 and went 7-0-10. Just gonna point that one out for anybody who's listening. But yeah, Meat Beats on the other side carried, you want to say carried by Seismic, but it really wasn't. Seismic took kind of a back seat during that game to Biscuit.
They really did. The games that they won, they were playing around Biscuit, and Biscuit played extremely well on the Jinx pick, on the... Did he play Kai'Sa game too? Is that right? Either way, he ended up playing extremely well and putting out a lot of damage. And it's interesting that this is the game of the week, considering Team Name Here was a team that you had ranked at the bottom in your preseason predictions.
Yeah, I thought that teams were going to really be able to exploit Captain Melonhead and Karasuda, who I think are maybe two of the weaker players in Gold Capped right now. Ethereum, also his solo queue's ranking back up, I guess, to where it's supposed to be, but was ranked Gold last season. I thought maybe that bottom side of the map might cost them in some of these games, but they played well against iTown. They had some interesting strategies that showed that they've taken a pretty good look inwards, and they have a good idea of where their strengths lie.
Yeah, and I think it's kind of a shame for them that the Kalista game is the one that gets shown on stream. You know, it's a great game to see. However, going forward, it'll be interesting to see, because that was a trick that they had up their sleeve that we're not sure if they'll have it, you know, going forward. And if that's the kind of trick that gets you a winning bot lane, then, you know, it could be an important one.
Yeah, so both undefeated teams coming in. The voting, really even. I think that's one vote, maybe two votes different, with Meat Beats taking it just very slightly.
Yeah, and I think that's actually kind of surprising that it is that close.
I don't really know who Glack GTO is either. Sorry about that. The G and the B are really close to each other. If I make one mistake a week, I'm pretty happy, by the way.
I think you're allowed a couple, at least, right?
Yeah, I'll say that. I don't know. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to this game to see if Team Name Here can continue that momentum, or if Meat Beats kind of solidify themselves as one of the top teams.
Agreed.
So our predictions, I think that we are not split in any regard, but we have OGR over Kings of Baron, Sensei Squad over GSM, Shme over iTown, and both have Meat Beats over Team Name Here.
Agreed. And for me, I think that it was really close in terms of deciding on the Sensei Squad versus GSM. So no flame against GSM. I just feel like Sensei Squad, I don't know, I feel like they'll end up pulling that one out.
Yeah. everybody else kind of agrees with us to varying degrees. The Kings of Baron versus Oklahoma Gold Rush. Apologies for the platinum. We'll shorten it to gold next week. But that one's a little bit closer than I expected, like the 57 to 42%. But the other ones kind of follow with the thinking, since they squad with a pretty strong percentage over GSM. And then Schmeh just kind of crushed I-Town in the vote.
Yeah, that one's... people don't have faith in the Quinn.
Yeah, I'm curious if we'll see Quinn get through at some point this season. And then if Quinn gets through, who actually plays it?
Maybe that's the real counter to the Quinn team, is to give them Quinn. And then their mental goes to shit as they're arguing over who actually gets to play it. It's the 10,000 IQ play.
Yeah. Jumping into gold, if you want to give us the schedule this week.
For sure. So we have Weird Flex But Okay against Ghost, Heartstuck Gold against ROTM, High Octane Gamers against Future Star Gamer 5, UCO Bronchos against the Sleeper Diamonds, and then Maximum Effort against AVRM2.
Wait, is Worstlock Captain Melonhead? Is this what we're learning? Because if that's the case, that's the best bot lane in the league, and we can go home anyway.
Wait.
We only have the info available, which is that it's a silver player. But if it's worse luck, you know, there's a chance. Anyway, our important match, the one to highlight this week, is High Octane Gamers versus Future Star Gamer 5. I messed up on the record, so it looks a little bit split. But the blue plus the orange is going to be for Hog, and the red is Future Star.
Yeah, I mean, and Hog coming in, taking the popular vote here. I mean, are we surprised?
Yeah, Hog seems like they've just come in and won the hearts of millions, honestly.
For sure. They came in, had a great tri-cast for Platinum. Is that who they tri-casted? I'm pretty sure it is.
Yeah, it was Hunger Bunger and then Pasta Boy and Bug7 from Hog.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, they had a really good showing last week. This week, I think this is a pretty big matchup, considering these are two teams that are likely to end up in playoffs together. So it'll be interesting to see who ends up coming out on top. Especially with, you know, High Octane Gamers did have a pretty good showing from Pasta Boy in the jungle on that Jarvan, at least in the game that was streamed. It'll be interesting to see if, you know, that early aggression with the pick like a Jarvan, what they're able to do against a jungler like Scrambles, who plays, I would say, more of like a tempered type of game style.
Yeah, and Future Star Gamer 5 coming off of the 2-0 over Flex last week. They were able to overcome the really fed Klepto Corki in the game that was on stream, and it showed well for their macro and decision making. I think that Hog might be another level. We saw them make that snap decision to go for Baron, and it'll be interesting to see if Future Star Gamer 5 can keep up with maybe that high tempo macro decision making with a little bit more of a herbivore jungler in Scrambles.
Agreed. I expect this to be a really good game. I wouldn't be surprised if this goes to 3. And if the one that's streamed is extremely close.
Yeah. Our game of the week is Heartstuck Gold versus Return of the Middle Sticks. I always hate talking about myself on stream. I know you're not as uncomfortable with it. but these are the teams that I had 4th and 5th, and I think you have 1st and 4th or something like that in your power rankings.
That sounds about right.
And it's the battle for who gets to claim if they're the defending champions last split or not. Because we have Propulsion's bottom lane and they have their jungle, their mid and top laner.
Yeah, so who ended up getting the better half of Propulsion? We'll see who ends up being able to take home that crown definitively. But, I mean, RTM was able to win last week, you know, without having a top laner, so that was interesting.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to their top laner last week, but just didn't quite show up for the games. Not really sure.
I'm not sure if he even showed up. You know, on stream I didn't see him. Was he sick? I don't know. I think the RTM needs to give Sky some pointers, because I mean Sky lost their 4v5, so RTM won theirs. It's interesting to see where they'll end up.
But realistically, Heartstuck Gold had a much more difficult week last week. I'll tell you who they played in a second when I remember. And it was Oh, it was UCO. So, honestly, both games against teams that were expected to be near the bottom of the standings and both took care of business. So this is going to be the real crank-up week for both teams.
Agreed. The first actual matchup, I'd say. You know, no flame against the teams that got beaten last week, but not as much expected from them. But this week, it should be really close. And again, these are two teams that are likely to play each other again down the stretch in playoffs.
Yeah. Other predictions, again, apologies about the Sleeper Diamonds one. I messed up the records. So they're red plus orange against the blue bar. And honestly, these votes aren't super close. I'm a little bit surprised at Weird Flex, but okay, getting such a gigantic percentage of the vote. But the other ones are pretty expected, honestly.
I guess that's a matchup that I don't expect to be a blowout. So based on the percentages, you would think that it's, you know, two teams that aren't even close to each other, but I guess I'm just kind of surprised seeing that percentage. I guess that they've won the people's heart.
Yeah, shout outs to AVRM2 for getting 20% of the vote. They've won our hearts, I guess.
At least 20% of them.
Yeah, if you want to go over the Shadow Isles schedule.
For sure. So first up, we have Team RKO against Landsnack, Yellow Jackets versus Ascended Royalty, Piltover Pokes against Taste Like Armageddon, Oklahomies against No Apologies, and then SEAL Team 6 versus Unnecessary Roughness.
So this Shadow Isle schedule wound up being super weird. So this is all teams that won last week versus teams that lost last week. So at the end of the week, we could have the exact same standings, just with a bunch of teams at 2-0 and a bunch of teams at 0-2. I don't think
it's kind of funny how that fell out.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to see that, but it could happen. I don't remember. I'm vaguely remembering which games we talked about. I wanted to talk briefly about RKO versus Landsnack. Sivir Me Timbers going up against Iron Man Fan and the squad, and White Shadow, I guess, is the team captain. Should probably mention him. But that should be a pretty good game overall. I'm curious to see. I think that's... Landsnack won their only game last split against Omega Wolves, which is kind of what RKO became. I think they're 3/5 of Omega Wolves. So I'm wondering if Landsnack had that circled on their calendars, like, this is going to be our win this split.
I mean, if they pick up a win here and double their wins from last, I mean, that's the way to do it. I think that this should be a pretty close game. And, you know, I think that Snack is looking up after picking up a game last week off of a tough matchup, I'd say. You know, coming into this week, they're probably riding a bit of a high. We'll see where they end up.
Yeah, I'm also really interested to watch No Apologies versus Oklahomies, which is another game I didn't highlight because I think, honestly, four of these five games are going to be really competitive. I think Unnecessary Roughness probably just smacks SEAL Team 6, unfortunately, but the other four are all going to be really close. But No Apologies has that really strong bot and mid. They have their two strong carries. Oklahomies had a rougher week, but they have Twitch in Space and Leave It to Wally to try to fall back on. I'm curious if they can really bounce back. They're a better, I think, overall, a higher skilled team, but No Apologies has better carries, and it'll be interesting to see if that trend kind of continues of the carries winning out.
For sure. And, you know, No Apologies is the one who pulled out the win last week, you know, against their matchup, so.
Yeah. So our important match that we wanted to highlight was Piltover Pokes versus TLM. This one, the Pokes are in kind of a rough spot. They lost last week against Ascended Royalty. This is a tough ask to go up against TLM in week number two. But falling 0-2 behind in a 9-game season, again, isn't a death sentence, but it's going to be really tough to climb into that fourth spot.
Agreed. We talked about it before, and you know, falling 0-2 is not where you want to be after 2 weeks. It's just a ton of pressure on that. And even if you do play, you know, an extremely difficult schedule in the first 2 weeks, if you drop 0-2, then you're not allowed any leeway after that. You have to win every game against people who you're expected to win against.
Yeah, and TLM coming off of the 2-0 week, probably feeling very confident. Seymour was a monster in their game. They have Levi's and Silver Spade to fall back on. They have a lot of flexibility in the way that they can play in their picks. And I'm I think they're feeling really confident. We're seeing the vote come out pretty heavily in favor of TLM as well.
Yeah, you know, they have a really strong lineup, and in coming off of the 2-0 week, I wouldn't be surprised if they end up coming back through and winning this one as well.
Yeah, and then our last match of the week to highlight. We picked Yellow Jackets versus Ascended Royalty. A lot of this kind of relies on our expectations, I guess, of Yellow Jackets based on their solo queue ranks, but they really need a bounce back week after getting smacked by Unnecessary Roughness. Granted, if everybody gets smacked by Unnecessary Roughness, you wind up coming out even out of that game.
Agreed. And looking at this matchup, you know, it is the battle of expectations in the Yellow Jackets, who weren't able to, you know, come out ahead last week, versus Ascended Royalty that ended up pulling out a win in a really close matchup. It'll be interesting to see where this one ends up, and you know, if Ascended Royalty's eight comms in the in between games really was able to help them secure a win in that series. But yeah.
Yeah, it's a really interesting matchup. I think that you and I have both picked Yellow Jackets, and then the chat actually going with Ascended Royalty for this one.
Yeah, I don't know if Ascended Royalty is just more popular, or it might be because they engage with Discord more than the Yellow Jackets. I'm not sure if I've seen any of the Yellow Jackets in Discord.
Yeah, I think I've seen Godzilla post in there once or twice, but that's everybody, the entire extent.
Yeah, so the moral of
Actually,
this story
that's a
is
lie. I know Zekrov said "oh" at one point because I was triggered. So
is that all it takes to trigger you, just an OO?
maybe, maybe I can't give away all my secrets. Anyway, the other predictions. The Unnecessary Roughness SEAL Team 6 vote was actually pretty close, which surprised me a little bit. But it's 55 to, well, 56 to 44 in favor of Unnecessary Roughness. RKO and No Apologies took a pretty big chunk of their votes for those games.
Yeah, and I just wanted to say real quick, the SEAL Team 6, last week, even though they ended up losing, Yobero, I don't know how the fuck to say his name, but he was popping off on the LeBlanc pick. He was playing extremely well. So if they're able to come back off of you know, that loss last week, and play around Yobero, I wouldn't be surprised if they end up making this a close series.
Yeah, and if I'm not mistaken, they also had to sub out Paladin, at least for one of the games, if not both of them, for the series. So missing your—I don't want to say your primary carry, but really that kind of fallback, the consistency for your team, and trying to rely entirely on Jobero. Maybe you grab that more consistent. You can give Unnecessary Roughness a fight. I don't personally see it, but I'd be curious if that's going to make the big difference for them.
For sure. It'll definitely be an interesting matchup to see. See if Yobert is able to repeat with another strong week.
All right, that's gonna do it here for us this week. A little bit shorter week, unfortunately, because my life is in shambles. Next week, it's going to continue to be in shambles. We're going to move to Monday at 6 p.m., which is just going to be a temporary move for next week because I'm out of town for Tuesday through Thursday. So we're going to see you a couple hours early on Monday. We're going to recap week two, preview week three, go over some memes for the week, hopefully grab some interviews in that time. I'm not going to guarantee anything, though. I'm also supposed to shout out Wing Nation's Alawi, which is fantastic. He really likes to ult without having any tentacles or targeting anybody.
Wing Nations Alawi, does he play that shit mid lane?
No. And in fact,
Oh.
probably shouldn't really play it ever.
Oh, okay. So this is just very directed flame then.
Yes.
Okay, I respect that.
So yeah, we'll see you guys next week. Again, Monday at 6 p.m. I'll announce it in the Discord server as well, and we'll try to do better next week.
Yeah, put it on your schedules and make sure that you show up.